9:05, call meeting's order.
Get a physical copy of it.
Like, do you entertain a motion to approve the minutes of the prior meeting, the 14 minutes of the special meeting? Okay, so we need a motion to approve the minutes of the prior meeting as presented.
So move.
Motion, do we have a second?
Second.
Is there any additions, corrections, discussion on the minutes of previous meeting as sent out earlier?
I didn't see anything.
Seeing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Any abstentions? Here, financial report.
Okay, you collected about $78,000 in taxes this month through $11,011.99 interest. There are seven checks today that total $1,178,891.27. Two unusual checks, final payment to E-Views, $172,500. And a check to Harris County District 18 for $98,533.88. That's your water and sewer tap for your new station. Balance is $4,503,409.98.
I'm sorry, the 98,533.88
is coming out of the loan.
Is it supposed to? They sent the invoice direct to us?
No.
We can get reimbursed for it.
Us, we can.
Sure. Either way, we can avoid the check.
We're getting, that was the plan to put that
in. I thought it was part of the loan.
Okay, investments drew $557.79. $18 service charge there at $6,182,191.57. Total funds are $10,685,601.55. Month 7 on your budget, you're about $700,000 over on revenues, and you're about $400,000 over on expenses, but you have almost a year's worth of reserves. Nothing's changed on investments. Rates are holding pretty steady. They're just not very good. Your money's pledged and secured at 138%. And I wrote one additional check, and I'm trying to get the invoices. It came in on my phone. And I may have to walk outside to get it to send to Barbara, but Urbanowski and Myers sent in their invoice for $7,393.50. And I'm assuming that's the auditor that you took to do.
So here do we outstanding the Cypress Creek?
Yeah. So all I have was yeah, I did. It came in. I missed it. Ever. I caught it myself. Angelique got it to me in time. I missed it.
I know. Is it being presented tonight?
Yes. I wrote it just now.
Yeah, we're good.
And then as soon as I can get the email forwarded to Barbara, she'll print out the invoices.
Make a motion.
Is that a motion? Do we have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on any report to the district treasurer's report? Seeing none, all in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Any abstention? Motion carries.
Or did you abstaining on that?
I was writing about it. I did indicate it.
Item number 3, pay district bills. You get a motion to pay the district bills presented by the bookkeeper.
So moved.
Second. Motion and second. Any further discussion?
Because today was such a special meeting, I actually flew in from the requested in person for, was it 472.50? For the plane ticket flying down, we had $5,000 budgeted for commissioner expenses for the year. We spent none of it. Requesting reimbursement for that expense.
Refer to Howard.
So why is this being presented to the district?
To attend a meeting. Because it's
brings up a question of why you're not in Harris County. in my opinion, but...
I'm attending school up there, but it's on that, but...
We have motion and a second, pay Mr. Bills as presented. Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Any extension? Motion carries. You can take action on the district investments. I'm not sure what that is.
Well, it's a standard item, not for me, we need a new investment.
Okay, so, action required there, moving on to the five. Nothing for the five, table that one for this meeting. Conduct mid-year budget review, amend the 2015 budget, amend the 2015 budget. Can you present?
I don't think we need one, but if, the only thing that we could put is that additional e-view stuff in there, but that's easily explainable to the auditor, so we really don't need to amend the budget for it.
The $400,000 that was shown to be over year-to-date, $100,000 of that was that $98,000 check we just wrote, correct?
No, that $172,000 check.
Well, so both of those combined will be roughly $270,000 of that overage up to this point.
Is that the e-view then?
The e-view check and then the $100,000 check to the water tap.
No.
No.
The water tap goes in...
That'll get zeroed out.
The water tap is under new EMS station construction.
Okay.
So that's how much we, $422,344 is how much we've written checks in this fiscal year for e-views. Now, understand, some of, the first check of the year may have been the final payment from the prior year, but it didn't get put in the books till this fiscal year.
Okay. So, pulling everything out, we're still back to where we should be pretty close.
Yeah, we're pretty close.
Do we have any more revenue coming in? I'm sure we have 72,280 that can come from fire departments. Do we have any more?
I'll have to look at the billings. I haven't, she didn't update them if anybody hasn't paid, but I think they all paid for this year. And of course, if that first payment was a prior year payment, the revenue would have come in last year for that. And if it didn't make it into the books until this year.
The auditor would fix that. And the audit would...
No, because they're gonna punch it out when it's fiscally spent. If it was written this fiscal year, but... You know, it'd all come out in capital gain.
Are we gonna have any more EV inspection expenses?
This year, we're good. Next year, we'll start talking about, at a meeting last week, discussing next year already.
Well, we can refine this at the next meeting for
this year.
The budget review that you have to do on the actual EV allocation.
Okay.
Just so that we have it really well.
Sounds good.
Okay, so there are no action required on item number six on the agenda.
Everything's...
Yeah, okay, so all in favor say, well, no action required, never mind. Were you gonna discuss the proposed 2016 budget?
Yeah, items 7, 8, and 9 will be leading up to the 2015 tax rate. We don't have certified tax rolls. I understand we have about August 25th is when certification, the double checking by HCAD, and then goes to the tax office, tax assessor, and they send it out. So,
do you have any numbers so far?
August 25th. Oh, I don't know what exactly the county gets. Once the county gets it, then they're still in the period.
No, that includes the county.
Oh, that's right.
Yeah, they're thinking certification of the tax rolls, they're expecting about the 18th or 19th.
Okay.
They then run a double check, they then send it to the tax assessor, and then the tax assessor sends it out.
Okay.
If there's information the tax assessor has to put into the report, and it must be OBR, the tax rate calculation. Fred, the only number we have is the initial taxable value of $38 billion. That's going to change. This is just the initial preliminary. So tax protests have not been accounted for. Missing or rental properties haven't been accounted for. So that number is a target, but it's not intended for...
It's not changing the market's valuation.
That's hard to say. Excuse me, from this number
last
here? There is an increase. You've got a sizable increase. So that... What the exact numbers are, is just really...
Well, I'm sure it takes some more months to really get to the final number.
Yeah, we probably won't have a certified tax roll for your August meeting. It'll probably come in a couple weeks after that. We may want to look at, just to keep the on our timeline, possibly having a special meeting between our August regular meeting and September 1st, about, just to get a jump start on working on the budget.
Yeah, to increase that budget. Actually, item number 8 and 9 are the same votes.
Yeah, 7, 8, and 9 are placeholders for the time being, but that's the discussion.
Table item number 7, 8, and 9, which will be appropriate to mention. Federal special meeting will schedule. Do you take action if it fails in 5-year plan? Are there any other additions or corrections to the 5-year plan?
Are we still on the... Do you guys have any changes to the... basically 30 years of building the station? The station's good for 30 years. Do you have any changes to that?
Well, the discussion that I think may not be included in there, but there's a separate agenda item under 16. Number 16. Take it up now, but about co-location.
Well, I was only speaking about the 30-year plan. Are we changing that plan that we've got in 2016? We're supposed to be adding 3 12-hour float trucks next year as well. Firefighter plans. Which... So that was just to discuss it, to review and discuss. Was the, you know, we're supposed to be adding 3 more trucks. It was basically completing the, when we added the 3 float trucks, there's some question about the 24 hours, and then we went to 12.
Do you think we need to amend it?
Well, we're discussing whether we need to amend that or not. So.
A question.
I think we need to discuss, are we going to be adding in 2016 basically the completion of those in 2014 when we added the 3?
2020 there was going to be 6 float trucks, right now we have 3.
When we added the 3 float trucks in 2014, mm-hmm. It was supposed to be 24 hours. And then it was that we went to 12 hours and there was some confusion about which one it was. So we agreed that in 2016 we were basically going to complete those 3 float trucks to 24 hours. And that's what we have on the 5-year plan. So if we need to discuss the 5-year plan, let's discuss it. But on the 5-year plan we have going basically those 3 float trucks instead of 12 hours in 2016 going to 24 hours. So that's what we have on the 5-year plan.
That's not the plan I proposed. Plan that we put out that had all the documentation that you've gotten almost every year was in 2020 there'd be 6 float trucks. 2014 we added 3 float trucks with the 13 stations. You're putting up a station sometime in October. We hired the people for that, so there'll be 14 24-hour trucks, 3 float trucks between 2015 and between 2016 and 2020, pending call volume. We will add another 3 trucks according, whether it's 1 in 2015 or 16, 1 in 2017, or 3 of them in 2019. That's yet to be determined, because right now our call volume is getting higher, but we're getting there quicker. So we're doing the right thing.
unfortunately, we don't have data that we've asked for on the slope truck, so we can't make an intelligible decision on that. We've asked our contractor numerous times for data on those slope trucks, and we can't seem to get any information about it.
So on.
So it's pretty tough to make a decision on a five-year plan when our contractor is spending our money and we don't know where it is.
And Medic 523 last month, it looks like it ran about 25 calls. We're supposedly paying an extra $500,000 a year for that truck alone to run 25 calls a month. Surely we can figure out a cheaper way to the taxpayers to get people to the hospital at less than $1,000 a call.
You said you didn't have any statistics. Where did you get those?
Well, I mean, there's no numbers on it. I'm estimating.
So you're making a statement. You don't know what you're talking about.
You know, that's what we're paid at the beginning. So we agreed that in 2016 we were going to be adding those two, not adding trucks, we're going to be adding them to be 24-hour trucks in 2016. That was our understanding of the whole discrepancy between adding float trucks, are they 12 or 24 hours? So the question was on the five-year plan, are we adding those in 2016 or not? Do we need to account for that on the five-year plan or not? I mean, I'm looking at this number here, which doesn't have a number next to it, but you know, we paid $50,000 last month for that truck to run 25 calls. That seems expensive to me.
That's all I had to go back and go.
I wrote the number back here.
I have no idea what he's got to
do. It's your report. It's your report. With what? You have your report right in front of you.
Right here. Well, you said you didn't have any information from.
No, we don't have dollar figures.
We don't have any dollar figures or actual numbers. I'm looking at a bar chart, which is. Pull it up, look at it. So I'm looking at Medic 523 there, which looks to me to be about 25 calls. There's no number next to it, but just. Gauging, it looks to be about 25 calls there.
Okay,
and we've paid an extra, it is, but we've paid $500,000, we increased $1.5 million the payment to the contractor to pay to add those three float trucks. There was some discrepancy about whether we, when adding those float trucks, it's a 12-hour truck or a 24-hour truck.
Never discussed.
But at the end of the day, we ended up with three 12-hour float trucks, which is okay. We finally all agreed to that. But now I'm looking at, well, you're being paid $50,000 a month to add that third float truck, and it ran 25 calls. And my concern is that certainly the taxpayer can figure out a more efficient way to get people to the hospital than having the taxpayer pay $2,000 to the service contractor per patient or per call. That's not even necessarily transported. That's just per call. I mean, that's $2,000 a call for that truck. That's my concern, is bang for the buck. If you look down at Medic 51, we're definitely getting our bang for the buck on Medic 51. I'm concerned about Medic 523, and I don't think the taxpayers are getting what they're paying for on that truck. That's my concern. That's a sidebar to the conversation about the five-year plan. Are we going to plan on either adding three additional float trucks or making the three float trucks we added in 2014 next year, either 24-hour trucks or adding three more float trucks? That's the discussion for the commissioners to talk about planning for the 2014 budget, because that's what we're going to be talking about.
2016.
I'm sorry, 2016 budget. That's what we're going to be talking about soon. That's the question.
Well, you need to do a workshop on the five-year plan before you get into the 2016 budget. Then, I mean, the 2016 budget for your time frame is going to be starting in September, first couple weeks of September, leading up to the your tax rate process. You'll certainly have it adopted by maybe a special meeting either at the end of September or beginning of October. So if you want to do a workshop on the five-year plan, I would think you would want to do it sometime between now and August 15th, maybe.
Sure.
Or maybe have it part of the August. My meetings go long enough. Maybe want to add it to the August meeting.
I don't know that we need a full special meeting for this question. The question is to the commissioners. We had discussed adding those three float trucks in 2016. Do you want to stick on that path, or do you want to now change it and revert back to what we've been doing in 2014 and 2015? The contractor seems to believe that the trucks are unnecessary, which That's what he just said. Did I misinterpret? That the additional...
I'd never say trucks are unnecessary.
Okay, so maybe I understood.
He said that we ran 50 calls with that truck, and you want to add three more trucks?
My question is...
So, no.
Okay, so he's saying that we don't need to add those three additional flow trucks next year. So now do we want to change that? It is on the five-year plan that we're adding them. That's my question. So do we need a full meeting to answer that question, or do we just need to answer it right here, and then we move on to the next agenda item?
So about deleting the three?
Deleting the three plan off the five-year plan and not budgeting for it, or do we want to go ahead and, you know, explore the options of budgeting for it and adding them or not? I mean, I would say Medic 51, those guys are some tired dogs at the end of that shift. And all the way up to Medic 55, 56, 57, I mean, anything over about 220 calls a month on a truck, those are some tired paramedics.
What is your total call volume on that? On the flow truck?
Total call by this staff?
On all three of them?
Probably 300 and some calls. Just a guesstimate. But they are for the month.
You're calling 521, 522, and 523 of the flow trucks, correct?
Right.
So I got about 130, that's 260, yeah, so about 3. So.
And they're flow trucks, they're only up half the time. And they flow through the district, so when 51 gets a call, one of those trucks is there, well, they already had called the district. Possibility of having two calls in the same area, it happens, but it doesn't happen a lot. And usually 51 gets back in service.
Can you?
The flow truck goes back in service or gets out of that territory and they run another call, so they go back in.
Is there a way for you to produce next month, when you produce this report, put the number of hours per call that each truck was in service and how many calls it ran per hour? Because I think that would be a more efficient number. Is, you know, if 523 was only in service half the time, then by looking at that, well, or if it was, you know, in a different area, looking at different numbers, this isn't really, you're right, because there's so many.
They're 12-hour trucks, so that's what they're on.
But still, it might not have been in service the whole time. No, I'm talking about runs per hour of service.
That's what I'm saying.
Yeah, basically.
So not just 12 hours, but how many times do it?
Actually, when it's in service. Because I don't think 523, Kevin, are you?
What do you mean by in service?
We've asked that question, and they refused to answer.
Responding right here.
So how many hours that truck is actually, not just 12 hours a day, but actually has a crew on it, in service, ready to run calls?
That's what 12 hours a day means.
Not necessarily. Not if the truck isn't in service. That's what I'm saying.
Okay, well, tell me what you mean by
Sunday.
Again, we've asked this question.
A crew on it.
And we've gotten a written response.
Ready to run calls is in service.
Right. We've gotten a written response that says they will not answer that question already. It's right here in the page. Line number 8 is the document we got in the special meeting last week. Medics 521, 522, 523. Give us a breakdown by month for each medic, the number of hours in service, i.e. 24 hours a day, 30 days a month, 720 hours a month, for the months 1-1-2014 through 531-15. And they declined to answer that question.
That's because this request was made under the Public Information Act.
It was asked directly by this board under our service contract, and you were informed of that question.
No,
exactly.
It was a Public Information Act request specifically identified to us as that.
I don't believe so.
By your attorney, that's right.
And then he
I'm not sure. Can you hand me that?
No. Yep, and he specifically said this is being asked under PIA as well as under the service contract. Okay. So we're paying for ambulances $1.5 million a year, and we don't know when they're on the streets.
You need to read the service contract or get someone to read it to you.
I'm not asking you a question, and again, you will be acknowledged when you are having a question directly directed at you, okay? Lynn, please keep order in this meeting again.
Mr. Jessup, Mr. McCain, can you guys agree that we don't have to request through the Public Information Act documents from our service contractor? That there's public information, and yes, we can make that, but then that there's another responsibility that the service contractor has to us as their funding agency that is beyond that of the public information. And you agree that that is allowed for in the contract?
Within reason?
Okay. Okay, so within reason, you're agreeing that as long as it's a reasonable request, I don't, would you agree that it's within reason for us to find out how many exactly, how many hours the ambulances are being used or not used?
So, I just want to be clear on what you mean by in service. If you mean available to respond to calls, fully crewed, if that's your definition of in service, not a problem getting you that information.
Okay. What would you, what's another interpretation of in service to you?
On a call.
Okay. All right. So, if it's on a call, then the truck is still available for call, it's just on a call. So, I'm looking for...
He's asking if we're shutting the truck down.
No.
Somebody calls and says, was that truck in service?
If the truck is sitting out in the parking lot, empty, then that's not in service. If the truck is at the hospital and the crew is transporting a patient...
Agreed.
That would still be included in your hourly log, it's just the crew is busy doing their job. So, that's the number I'm looking for, is how many hours you paid a crew to be on that truck.
And the crew's actually on.
And the crew's on the truck and treating patients or not.
I think the number is 12 hours a day for each of the floaters.
Is that 5 days a week? Is that 7 days a week? How many times is there not three trucks in service?
We feel like it may not be that number.
There's 521, 522 are 12-hour trucks, 7 days. 523 is not yet.
Well, how many days is 5? So that's my question. So 523 is 5 days. So then there's the number of, you know, that's is it 8 hours? Is it 12 hours? Is it? So that's my question. Can you look up and put how many all hours that truck is in service for the month, and then how many, and then just it's easy division of how many calls it brings.
Every call 12 hour truck.
Yes.
But if somebody goes home early, somebody gets called and sick, like you said, there may be days where it was scheduled to be in service, but it's not. So I'm looking for, at the end of the month, how many hours that truck was actually running, actually had a crew on it, and either on a call or available to make a call, and then how many calls it brings. I don't think that's an unreasonable number. Would you agree?
I don't.
Okay. Would you agree that the documentation to support that is a reasonable request?
It doesn't. We don't have a separate set of documents that shows how many. It would be a report. It would be that granularized. You would have to derive the number from looking at a variety of documents. That it's just easier just to figure out who's on the trucks, how many hours they were paid today on the trucks, and get you a final number. But we're not going to tell you that it's the only thing. That's a whole different
conversation. I don't want to open that can of worms right now. Right now we're talking about, my original question was, is there a way for you to put a number on here,
yes,
how many hours it was in service, and then divide that by the number of calls it ran, and that will give us a little better understanding of which trucks we're getting more bang for our buck on. I don't feel like we're getting much bang for our buck on 543.
Well, but you have to keep in mind, bang for the buck is determined by how many accidents, heart attacks, and other calls for service there are. But we don't know in advance how many calls there might be, and we'd like to have sufficient resources out there to address those calls. And in our view, it's better to err on the side of caution and have a little bit more than you need and not quite enough.
Again, my bang for the buck is just like we said. We have a discrepancy of whether these were supposed to be 12-hour trucks versus 24-hour trucks. Most services can put a 24-hour truck in service for $350,000 a year. We agree for $500,000 a year. We were just told that we know 523 isn't even in service 12 hours a day, 7 days a week. So we know we have a discrepancy in funding here based on what we paid for the last 2 years and what we're getting. But that's where this really needs to go. We paid for X, we're getting Y, what are we going to do about it?
You only pay for what is used.
If we paid $500,000 for each truck to go on the street 24 hours a day, 7 days a week.
That is not.
You put them on this road 12 hours a day, but now you're going to be telling us one third of the money we're giving you isn't even being utilized for that 12 hours a day, 5 days a week. So we have a discrepancy in what we paid for and what we thought we were getting versus what we're actually getting.
Actually, what we have with discrepancy is in understanding how the system works.
Not at all.
You're not paying a penny, not paying one penny for hours that are not actually worked by a CCEMS employee. So if you think you're paying $50,000 a month for a truck it's not staff, and it isn't going anywhere, they're simply mistaken.
No. We made a budget assignment in fiscal year 2013 for 2014 that we would give y'all an extra $1.5 million a year for three more trucks. Some of us thought those were going to be 24-hour trucks. Obviously, y'all thought they were going to be 12-hour trucks. And we're not even getting 12 hours a day, 7 days a week.
You're going to interrupt and can't respond to your ridiculous, acrimonious...
We're just wasting time, so we have a disagreement. This is what we're talking about in our fighter plan. We need numbers to make informative decisions. So let's get down to...
Let's table the five-year plan until we have solid numbers on how many calls and how many hours those trucks actually...
We need a special workshop to...
I don't think so. If he just brings the information, it's an easy decision, but we have to have the information to do it, to make the decision.
Thank you for the information.
Yes.
Thank you.
We will table item number 10.
Yes, sir.
Is this your characterization, so I want to break in exactly what the information is, so when it comes, either it is or isn't?
I want to see how many, we've defined in service, right? I want to see how many hours those trucks were in service per month, and then an actual number of how many truck, how many calls each truck ran in those hours. Obviously, trucks aren't in service.
Going back how far?
Oh, just the month, just...
No. January 1st, 2014.
From the history of the flow.
That's going to take longer to assemble. We will get you what we have.
Can you at least agree? Can you at least agree to the monthly next month? And then if it takes longer to get the back information, we can work through that.
We will do the job consistent with discharging regular duties of the company and give you an interim report next meeting and another interim report if it's not a final report, and a meeting after that. We'll see that we are attempting to get you that information.
Okay, so how many hours of truck is in service is the definition that you come up with, and then how many calls they made during those times?
Correct. By truck, divided down by each ambulance driver. That'll work. That's just a discussion.
We're all going to need an agenda item.
Is it? It's just on the review and discuss?
It's going to be reflected in the minutes, you know.
Review and discuss next to the five-year district plan.
So five-year plan really is not tabled, we took it out, it's just no action, but this will reflect it as information we need.
To make action next month for whatever reason.
Okay, number 11, we get the action taken, operation funding pursuit to Cypress Creek EMS.
So we move this item until after item 18?
Second. Do we need a second?
Y'all would like to? Table item number 11 until after item number 18. Item number 12, we take action on capital funding, or the capital this month.
To Cypress Creek?
Cypress Creek EMS. Through capital. No action required on 12. Monthly operations and financial report from Cypress Creek EMS.
As I said earlier, we're running more calls and we're still getting there with the average response time of 8 minutes and 3 seconds. For the month of June, we ran 3,141 calls. Each month, we're running over 2,000 calls, other than the month of February, which all last year, every month, we ran around 2,800, 2,900. So we're running about 1,200 more calls this year than we did last year. We did have 6 live flights through the month of June. Our STEMI process right now, going into the fourth year, is 506 calls. We're still at the 98% success rate in calling those STEMIs in the field. That hasn't changed for a long time. Along with that, we did receive 2 awards from Methodist Hospital for our stroke volume and our STEMI calls for the number of our times and responses to that location throughout Texas. And we were 3 years in a row one of the best ones that have come in there with our times. 9 mutual aid assists in our territory. We had 19 mutual aid assists outside of our territory. We are changing up some of the protocols. As you know, some of the medications that we've had no longer exist. They quit making them, so we're changing some things on there. So that'll be an ongoing process for the next couple months. We did have a one-day workshop with a demo from AEDs for our service. We're still looking at other ones coming in, so before we do that, we want to get the fire departments involved in that also. And I already talked about the award, so that's where we're at.
What's the thing on C-spine?
There's a new protocol out there that other services are going to, where they clear it in the field. The paramedic does, so we want to put on backboards and C-collars and all that. We're looking into that right now.
I guess I'm keeping the word clears. Is that?
A paramedic would clear it in the field instead of putting it on a backboard, taking it all over the hospital. Then the doctor say, take this off, we don't need it. Same thing, we'd be clearing in the field instead of.
Minor fender benders where like the patient really has no distracting injuries, they're not intoxicated, they don't have anything else that would hide the neck injury, they're fine. And right now, and the old way of doing things, you had to take them down to backboard or strap them down to backboard, which is time consuming and uncomfortable for the patient. Now basically we're going to be, if my understanding is it's correct, as long as the patient doesn't have a distracting injury and they're fine, you just put them on the strap and take them to the hospital.
Is it giving any more independent authority to the paramedic?
Yes.
To making that decision?
Yeah. Through classes and through education, then, yes.
Previously, they were.
Lot of like the standing program with the paramedic in the field.
Lots of major services.
Right, but there's ongoing communication to the hospital about the standing.
Sure.
Patient in the end, so is the.
No, when we call the standing, we don't talk to them. We just said the standing will come, it'll be there in 10 minutes. So same with this, it's just, the hospital, all they would know is it's a motor vehicle accident and the patient would be on a stretcher coming in and the patient was up walking around for 3 hours, complaining of no neck pain, however, mechanism was an injury, the car was in a wreck. But the patient's stable, no headache, no dizzy, no nausea, no diaphoresis, no this and all that. So the patient stable, however, we wanted to check.
Right, giving a little more local authority in the field.
That's correct.
This is lots of other services that we've been for quite a while, so it's good that we're doing it. It's more comfortable for the patients, for sure.
Can you give us an update on all your criminal and civil things going on? I don't see anything in your Cypress Creek EMS Board of Directors meeting minutes about anything going on. I know last special meeting we were informed that you're going to sue the state of Texas again. Can you just kind of give us an update on all the civil and criminal issues going on with your organization?
Is that on the agenda?
It's under, it's under his report.
Contract, let us know of any new litigation or anything going on.
Yeah, actually, I report that to your council, which is what I've got, and there's nothing to do.
Could you give it to our council again?
Was there a lawsuit filed in the most recent AG that came in?
That was subpoenaed. I got subpoenaed again in court, but basically the paperwork, to my understanding, wasn't filled out properly. The first subpoena should have said, do we have these records? And then the second subpoena said, we want these records. We only got one subpoena that says, we want the records. And at no time did anybody ever clarify whether we had them or not. That's what the second subpoena was that I was served with them.
And who is this from? Who is this from?
It's from Harris County. It's from Harris County. Yeah, it's in connection with the charges sworn out by Wayne Dolcefino. It's a misdemeanor. And it's to get the salary records of our employees. We're going to assist them if we told everyone we were doing very good.
So did we get an answer? Yes, so no, they have filed the second lawsuit against the AG?
There's no new lawsuits have been filed. Court, and typically we don't discuss pending litigation. All we're required to do on the service contract is notify the district if there's a lawsuit, which we do.
I think we can only prepare to have a question after the session meeting last week or two weeks ago. We had just received an AG letter instructing that certain documents had to be released, and the attorney who was here from the firm said he was trying to file a lawsuit against that.
in connection with the AG rule, as we're required to do, right?
That's what he's asking, the lawsuit.
That lawsuit has been just recently filed, yes.
You gonna send a copy?
I will.
So there has been another one, so you have two pending against the Texas AG?
We have three separate lawsuits pending against the AG's office. One has to do with payroll records, the other two have to do with the same type of documents, confidential documents that the tactical team, the Ccemsa tactical team is really charged with keeping confidential. One is a description of documents as a whole that we have, and another is just email and text message communications with respect to the tactical team.
And that was the one that was subject of the most recent AG's, because the AG actually went through and checked each of the different responses that they were on to determine which was criminal in nature, that could not be the biggest thing, that which was not, that couldn't be.
So I read the AG opinion on the tactical team documents that need to be released. What in that did you disagree with, that you feel like he, or the Attorney General's office, did not correctly interpret the law?
The most.
I'd really rather not discuss strategic issues and pending litigation. It's not part of the service agreement, ESD 11, we're in litigation. I'm pretty sure that your attorney would not want you discussing lawsuits in a public forum, that's what executive session is doing.
Ms. Jessica, can you make sure that we get a copy of the original petition soon? Not by close business today.
The second part, you know, we're missing several months meeting minutes still, and I know you had said you had a couple still ready to give us, but we're still meeting several, still missing several of your regular meeting minutes from your board meetings.
There was two sets in last month, so there's a set.
Okay. I don't see in any of your meetings, maybe I'm missing something, that you're ever discussing any of this stuff in regular session or in executive session.
We're going to executive session, and it states that in the minutes we went into executive session.
And what we talk about in executive session remains in executive session.
Oh, I agree 100%.
You're not going to find any discussion of our litigation.
Show me on the May meeting where there was an executive session. I'm sure y'all had to be discussing the numerous issues that y'all are going through.
I mean, Howard, wouldn't we be required, if we were going to file a lawsuit against, Woodlands, wouldn't we be required to, in public meetings, make that determination and do that?
No, we don't have to broadcast in advance that we have seen somebody.
Should have been a lawyer.
But I see that didn't seem to be an executive session with these sets of minutes, right?
Okay, so taking the conversation away from the pending litigations, I'm concerned. I've gotten some emails about, my understanding is the CAT team guys, they carry their commissions as certified peace officers through water. Is that correct?
They carry them through several agencies, not just.
Okay. So yourself, for example, you're TPO certified, correct?
I don't want people knowing I'm a police officer, and I can't believe that you just did that. Do you know what I do?
I'm asking.
That's not appropriate.
So there's some concerns.
So you don't care about my life if I'm out there doing something?
Okay, so there's some concerns that the Waller County Sheriff's Department has that maybe some of your reserve officers or people who are supposedly acting as police officers here are not on the reserve officer list there and are claiming to be meeting the requirements in Waller County.
Is this a concern that's being expressed by someone in Waller County?
Yeah, the Waller County Sheriff, who's the person who carries their commissions, says that the reserve members that are claiming here that they're reserve members there and operating as police officers here are not on his rolls or rosters or meeting the requirements required of reserve officers there. means now we've got people here acting as police officers or doing that work when they shouldn't be, which would be a concern to me. I will avoid the conversation about whether they're really police officers working for an EMS agency or not, but that would be a concern to me. And I've looked at the roster of the reserve deputies and don't see many of the names on there that I recognize. So could you provide
I know what you're asking.
A roster of the people who you have on the CAT team, which agency is carrying their, which agency is carrying their commission?
It's confidential. I mean, would you want, if you did undercover work or you did some things, you want people to know that you're doing? You're going to jeopardize their lives.
You can see my concern. Because if one of those guys acting as a police officer comes out and it turns out that he's not, I mean, I can guarantee you the Waller County Sheriff is not going to have a problem dropping him saying, hey, he's not part of our agency. And then we have a litigation ongoing because the guy, whether innocently or not innocently, committed some kind of tort or liability. Now, we're the ones that are on the hook, or Cypress Creek's the one that's going to be on the hook, and I don't want to see that, so I'm trying to stem that off.
Your concern for Cypress Creek is noted and appreciated. I note that you are not the Waller County Sheriff, and I assume that you have a concern for Cypress Creek or any of its personnel, you can let us know correctly. And that'll be a conversation that we had with that person, probably not you.
So
if we have employees who are certified peace officers, their roles in law enforcement will remain confidential. The fact that they are in law enforcement will remain confidential because of the oftentimes sensitive nature of their role. We're not going to disclose it in public. It's not going to happen.
Okay.
So we can move on to another topic, or we can beat this one to death. Why is it of any interest to you that there are commissioned peace officers on the payroll of Cypress Creek EMS? Are you worried about a tort? Because torts more likely happen operating vehicles. That's where torts mostly come from.
Well, I'm also concerned that when we asked you for the SOGs for the CAT team, you responded that there were no SOGs, SOPs for the CAT team, which is concerning to me that now you've got a team out there operating and doing things with no guidance at all, which is probably not that great of an idea. And again, that's going to come back to the liability on the SD-11 of allowing that kind of activity to continue. And I'm not saying that what these guys are doing is not correct. I'm saying that, you know, when things go badly, then all of a sudden it's, well, what were you doing to oversee it? And so we've done nothing.
Let's be clear, and then you ask a couple of questions also. But for one thing, we don't contract with them anything but EMS service. So the CAT team, exactly what it is, CAT team, and how are they funded? So the CAT team is what?
I'm honestly not sure. My understanding is it's some kind of quasi law enforcement agency tactical response team.
It's a special unit that we have for long operations. If a two-alarm fire goes out, three-alarm fire, and the fire department's going to be out there 12, 14, 16 hours, instead of taking a 24-hour ambulance or a float truck out of service to stand by, we activate the tactical team. They are a group of medics that go out there. They are have special medical care that they can do that are long operations, sutures, minor things like that. They also, some of them, not all of them, some of them happen to be police officers throughout several counties in this area, from Precinct 4, Harris County, Montgomery County, Waller County. It is just not Waller County. They are from all over. They are current on their CEs. They are current on their qualifications for their departments.
Are they different in nature, different in identification from the people we routinely think of being paramedics on your EMS trucks?
They are paramedics on the EMS trucks. They are paramedics that ride on a daily but have had additional training. And when they get called out, if a federal agency calls out and says, hey, we have this big warrant, we want your medics there because they are trained with us, we want them there, they go there as a medic. They are not wearing machine guns, running around, shooting people.
So they don't carry assault rifles?
I don't know what they carry when they do at their own commission. When they're on our ambulance.
When they're in a Cypress Creek ambulance, they don't carry assault rifles.
I've never seen one. Now, if you've seen some that I have.
That was a yes or no question.
I've said, I've never seen one.
So why don't you make that the first policy of your new SOG? No assault rifles.
I'm not going to designate what a law enforcement agency wants that person to have, because if they go somewhere else.
On our ambulances, I think that you have every right to say that.
So if the FBI calls us and says, hey, there's all these flooding and hurricanes again in Louisiana, we want you there, and here's, we want you to have this, because I know you're trained in it. I'm going to send them.
The big picture is we don't see any differentiation in the funding. Those people are getting paid by taxpayer dollars to go to Louisiana, and I don't think the taxpayers of ESD 11 would think that's okay.
They went once.
Humanitarian effort, you don't think that's okay?
They went to state office calling.
Even worse, would you want warrants to go to Sugar Land?
Yeah, in Sugar Land?
Why are we doing warrants in Sugar Land?
That's ambulances on the street money.
How do you know you're doing warrants?
We don't.
He just told us.
Well, why are you even assuming warrants in Sugar Land? I'm just trying to get a picture.
We're not assuming.
They serve warrants?
They serve warrants all over where? The state, all over, where, how far away do we go?
Mr. McKinney already said we're not going to, it's in litigation, right?
No.
At the end of the day, this is one of the things you wanted from the Attorney General's office, all the information, where we go, how we go. All you're going to do is jeopardize someone's life by, we go on this location.
How much they're being paid.
And the individual is not there. We're not going to give you that information of what house we just went to, because he's not there, so we're waiting for the next time.
Brad, how many calls does the tax give you a month after?
I give that to you every year, it's in your report, I can go bring it up on my computer, I think last year we did 87.
87 is all, are you?
But don't, I don't want to say a number, because I don't have.
100-ish. 100-ish.
Is what we did last year, I can go bring it off my computer and give you the exact.
And those people are being paid with ESD 11 funded money.
But they just don't, see, and this is where your conception is, they just don't do police.
Okay.
When there's a fire standby, two alarm, three alarm, four alarm fire, that medic goes out there in that special truck.
Okay.
Now, do some of our medics that work here carry firearms? The answer is yes. We have FBI agents that ride on the ambulance here. We have DE agents, U.S. Marshals, they ride as volunteers. Their office says that they will carry their weapon 24/7 all the time. The days that we live in now, all law enforcement agencies do the same. You carry your weapon 24/7. Are they signed off on there? By me, do I know who has a weapon on our ambulance and who does not? The answer is yes.
Okay, again, I think the point we're trying to get at is ESD 11 tax dollars going to pay for this tactical response team that has nothing to do with wheels on the ground in ESD 11.
It does when you go to fire.
Is the question then, we find specific line items, right? So you're asking that when you do 2000, the next budget, that service be deleted from the line item that we find?
At least delineated to see how, because at this point, we don't even know how much it's costing. If it's only 87 calls, and it's only costing a small amount of money a year to have that team, well then, sure. If those same 87 calls are costing us what the 23 calls cost us on Medic 523, well then, maybe we ought to look at, again, bang for the buck to the taxpayer.
We're going to have a discussion. It means, I appreciate that the dollar amount may be bid, may be low. That's important. But if we're going to talk about the principle of, is this intended to be funded by ESD 11 that Kevin is bringing up, and I think that's where the focus needs to be. You know, I mean, it's not, I mean, let's say.
It's not just calls, it's training. It's all the things that have to do with it that our money, I believe.
Right, and all those items, I think, can be delineated on a line item budget. I mean, that we fund specific line items. And so if there are issues that we say, okay, we don't want to fund this, then I think that's a discussion that we need to have. And I think that's what that's
Let's bring it up as a 2016 thing, but we need to have those items delineated out so we can see exactly how much they're costing and then make the decision instead of flying blind. Just saying it's all lumped into this.
Cypress Creek, I don't think Mr. McKinney's ever taken exception if you haven't really asked that, but I don't think there's an issue on the dollar amounts involved with district funding to the program.
Gross dollar amount is never an issue. The issue is strictly
maintain 45%.
There's a lot of overtime that goes into those extra hours that are done by the ambulance. So I think we can come up with what that number is, and if you want to say, we're not funding that component of it.
But it does not tie up the ambulance that would be on the road.
Does not.
Or a blood truck.
And they go to state operations when the state set trap comes in, or anybody comes in and says, hey, there's flooding down here. We want each department, can you send one or two ambulances? We send an ambulance because the state has asked us to.
And by the way, that's the standard care all over the country. Every time there's a bad storm or a disaster in New York, folks come from California to help out. We do our part.
Sure.
That's an issue.
And that gets reimbursed by the federal government, so we don't have issues.
No.
So to go into our budget process and budget review, this is 911. The information.
Well, and it was already brought up in the special meeting as well, that the auditor, Ccemsa, auditor's going to separate it into categories, give us numbers that we kind of do, so it's just an ongoing.
The auditor.
Same ongoing request.
Right.
And working.
I do have a question about your audit, but does everybody have a copy of it? Everybody seen a copy of it?
Right, you can give us a copy of your 2014 Cypress Creek audit.
What's your question?
There was a line in there that I don't know what it means. You're paying one of our board members $1,000 a month for use of something?
Huh?
What board member?
It's in their audit. I don't know.
Well, there's a, yeah, I think you're talking about a lease agreement that predates the district that Brenmeyer had with Cypress Creek.
Oh, for his rent.
I don't know. I just saw that in the line. I might know what it was, so I'm just asking.
It's a building he uses for.
We don't have it anymore. It hadn't had it for years. And he disclosed it when he became.
I saw that in there. It was in your 2014 audit.
He used to use it for medical or something.
Yeah, we had reviewed that.
So you're not using anymore?
We haven't used it for years.
That's been in use for 5 years.
So why is it in the audit?
I don't know what you're looking at.
That was in a note. I think as you look at that audit, there's a lot of notes that they just carry over from one year to the next, and.
So the audit's incorrect?
The audit is incorrect.
Not incorrect, it's just information that has been in the past.
It's not.
Disclosure that it was a commissioner that, yes, we did rent from him years ago. We don't do it anymore.
It's not, it's in the notes section, which was not, I mean, I'm not saying it's right or wrong. What I'm saying is, it's not in the numeric number of how they receive and spend money. It's in the notes section, and it is inaccurate or correct.
It is inaccurate, okay. I didn't know what that was.
I mean, it's inaccurate also, as we discussed, at the meeting where they list our money for some reason as donations.
Correct.
And one of the things that we're trying to work out with Cypress Creek EMS is, when you look at that number, we can't necessarily differentiate how much of that is true donations that they receive, how much of it is volunteer hours that they receive, and how much of it is the money that we get. And I think at the special meeting, it was even requested that Cypress Creek ask their auditor to revise that to show.
It was, yeah, where they were going to separate it.
Yeah.
But you were going to send him a letter.
Say what?
I thought you were going to send him a letter.
I don't think your auditor's going to take a letter from me, unless,
I've talked to him about it already, but I told him that there was a letter coming from you that, I've already talked to him about it. He said they can change it, so.
I get clearance that they'll accept a letter from me to do something on your audit. I'll be happy to send it. But the key is, I've been looking to get that number because it is composed of multifaceted sources of money and also of apparently an evaluation of volunteers.
It would be nice if you had a paper trail on. Copy your request to the audit, look at those issues. Anything else on your audit?
Hey, we're on 13, we're on the 14.
Any other discussion on item number 13? On
Moody's, we actually received it, we don't approve it or receive it.
All right, moving on to item 14, you take actions for AEDs, I understand you're still evaluating them.
Right.
Well, I'm sorry, on 13, we do take action to receive it. It's not a question.
A motion to receive the report, subject to.
Make it.
Second. Any further discussion? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition, any extensions? What is here?
On item 14, so we got, is this being, when this purchase is made, the AEDs, is it being done through state contract?
Right now, we're just looking at, once we get them all down, then we'll contact HGAC or I'll get individual ones and bring them all in here and say, okay, do you guys want to fund this or you want us to?
So we're taking 14, this time, no action. Do you even take action on about 13 minutes?
We're still on track, the facility's come along nicely. We're actually going to be meeting next Tuesday in lieu of this past week. The project manager is on vacation, so I'd like for him to be present. The only item we have is the pay up and then for this month pay up and then the blanket easement. I'm going to get that signed. Part to Lynn just before it needs to be notarized, so there's two copies.
Now, this is later than the subject to the specific reference to where the easement's been.
Correct. And it's identified.
It's utility setting.
Is this exactly?
Obviously, since that's the easement, that's because we still don't have these. I mean, we still don't have electricity, right? No. And just to kind of give, if you look at the exhibit at the back, essentially these electrical service for both facilities coming in on y'all's property along the east side and going to the back of the building. It's going to be a pad mounted transformer back there. There will be discussion in the project meeting. The developers looking at possibly using that feed for the adjacent property as well. I will obviously talk to Howard before that happens.
Is he getting an offset fire station?
To the east. In which case, I would, I'll let you.
For a future possibility, because of the cost offset, if they're going to use.
Well, that's one thing. But again, you're talking about permanent easement.
Now I have a problem. Because we know the fire station.
Correct.
Because they possibly want to extend this to, they have further development. How do I know?
No, it would be through permanent easement. And again, it would be, I see it not moving forward. Again, I would not talk to Howard, but based on my knowledge of how that works. Well, because we'd have to have a permanent easement come over off of y'all's easement. And then once you do an easement, you know, you dedicate that easement, you no longer build on that property. And it's, you know, it's a prior utility.
You can put fences over it.
Right.
You're not going to put it back when they're done.
Right. But like I said, it's an issue of, you know, I know Bill Walker out there, he's been part of that discussion. I just don't see us granting easement to the adjacent property.
Unless they want to buy our intersection.
And why do you say this guy can move?
No, this is just for RE. I'm just talking about future that discussions that we're talking about.
That may come up.
Right. But again, I don't know if we'll have it for this next month or next week's meeting. But we'll discuss that. I was ready to look forward as well. Well, no, this one is just RE.
I understand what it is. I'm not prepared to approve this yet. Granting further reserves the right to extend services and grantor's property to adjacent entities. That could be their further development, their future residential development. mean, when we first talked about this, we wanted to make sure we get service and of course extend to the fire department.
Correct.
But this is a blanket easement that can now involve other properties and we don't necessarily know where their utility connections would be. So, I'm pretty honest, I need to hold on this to future review. And this may be delaying things, but I just can't see giving approval now without having more information about where these utility connections might be. As far as just giving a blanket easement, that they can then use that as the commencement to extend utilities to not just the fire station, but to the country development.
I mean, and that's the problem with the blanket easements. I mean, that's...
Right, but whenever we've done blanket easements before, it was always connected with service to us. But we now have on the plan themselves.
Correct.
Adjacent properties. We need to hold.
Make a motion to be hold until pending council's instructions. Was discussed figured out.
Well, yeah, and if I could just ask, if we, again, I don't want to delay Station 513 and certainly the fire station, but we need to get this resolved. If we need a special meeting before your August meeting.
How about we just direct you to act on our best interest, whatever that is, and you can, when it's ready, you can sign it.
You all need to take it up at a meeting if you're going to approve it. I mean, I would obviously go through the document and request some revisions with the Carter, but in terms of getting it approved, we'd all be open to maybe the special meeting that we have in August to commence your tax rate process. The other item under 15 is to probably take action to request the reimbursement from your loan for the
I'll make that motion.
Motion, do we have a second?
Second.
Any further discussion on that part of the motion? Does it get reimbursed? All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? Any opposition? Is there a draw?
There is. It's in the amount of $287,486.58. If y'all have any questions on the general be specific, like I said, it's come along.
I saw the flags. Does that mean the top is complete?
It's not going to be topped out.
Just mystery of Brian's. Yeah, I make a motion to pay the 287 figures.
Motion, we have second.
Second.
Any further discussion? That's how the paperwork decides.
Karen says aye. Karen says aye.
Sorry. What were we voting on?
We're paying for the 287 to pay.
Yes, okay, sorry. Yes.
Anything else?
Other than that, that's all we have. Like I said, we have our project meeting next week, so we'll get some additional information.
All right. Further discussion with that person? Co-location between ESD 7.
I've been out of town. We had a meeting scheduled for yesterday, and it got called off yesterday afternoon, so we haven't had any more discussions about it.
Have any it's Station 75. Yeah. Oh, so we'll keep on.
I got some emails from
I talked to Bob and
ESD
They basically told him, I'm waiting on the report to show them to us again. But he was expecting us to do something today, but he didn't indicate there would be an issue with them. They're on a time crunch, but it's not that bad of a time crunch.
So is another workshop, another meeting where the committee's supposed to start?
Yes.
Okay, item number 17, are there any other discussions on 75?
Real quick on item number 16. I got some emails that I'll forward to the other board members from members of the public. Apparently, the homeowners association there, is it North Hampton? That subdivision right outside 75. Apparently, they're aware that there's some discussion of whether we're going to be building a station there or not. And they were obviously in support of us building that station. So the public is paying attention to it and want us to build that station and the station 75. So that's just the comments that I got from the public on that issue. Item 17.
Third party communication, really desperate to let Creek EMS in operation.
What do you think we need to talk about, and what do you think we don't need to make?
Well, this is the letter that was referred to and intended and written to John. That we went over to the special meeting where he had made a request, and we had received a request from a member of the public that was forwarded on to Cypress Creek EMS. They did give limited response, a point of perception based on privacy issue and also pending litigation. This item and item 18 and item 20 kind of all go together.
You going to do EV real quick before we do 17, 18? Because we've got 11. We've got 17, 18, 11, and 20. Let's do EV. We can get termite out, and we'll take those four to block. EV?
That's fine. Howard, or Fred? 263 intersections completed as of this week, I believe. This year's installations should be finished today or tomorrow. The gentleman's been here for 4 weeks on all the installations. They have recognized some text dot wiring issues. I may have reported on this last month. Ground issues within control boxes. Text dot is fixing those. Those are primarily along FM 1960. We had a meeting last week where we're going to start working on the 2016 plan. It appears that the majority of those intersections will be in the spring area, spring ESD. Primarily, Ponderosa's built out, Cypress Creek Fire is built out. Klein has new intersections, and other than that, that's all we know at this point.
You know about how many new intersections?
No, we don't know yet. Next year. We're trying to put that list together now.
Fred, on a scale of percentage complete with that project, where do you think
90?
We are?
90. Yeah. And what's happening, though, like TC Gesture, they're between 60 and Spring Cypress. There's 7 or 8 new signals being installed there. And those are in Klein's plan, but we don't know exactly where it's going to fit in. But we're right about 90% right now.
So now it's almost kind of approaching as sort of the maintenance end.
That is correct. That is correct.
Anything else on Coventry reneging on their promise?
Yeah, I haven't. Okay. But my question is, last month there was an issue about I-45 in Kirkendall with TxDOT. Something about TxDOT's review process was changing. It becoming a little bit more laborious for you to get some approval.
Our internal TxDOT rep is handling all that. They've made significant progress within the last 2 weeks. That is a little bit related to the electrical issues.
There are still some controller issues, but TxDOT seems to be moving in the right direction.
What Lynn's referring to is there's always an understanding that Spring had with, Spring Fire Department had with the Coventry Development.
Also us, we were at these meetings.
Well, and that they were going to be participating in the new EV installations that were going to go up on Discovery. So we raised that with Coventry, but that was a discussion. I think it may come down more to how many are they picking up, because what I remember the discussion was around the station facilities, they were going to pick up the cost of.
I remember every intersection going to Coventry there, except the one that was already there. That was.
What will they do with you then?
Okay.
Hey, Fred, just one last question.
Yes.
On our 2016 budget, last year, 2015, we budgeted $100,000. Actual year to date, it's about $450,000. Would you change the budget or you change the actual? So then for a 2016 budget, which we're going to start working on, what would you, you say you're 90% complete?
We don't know. I can't give you a number now. I mean, if you just want to plug a placeholder, put 100, just as a placeholder. It's too early for us to put that into the numbers now.
Okay, thank you.
100 placeholder for EV, for ESD
11, sorry? Yeah, ESD 11.
ESD 11 for 2016.
Basically just said he's got placeholders for a bunch of verbiage on the website. Robert and I are going to start working on that. I've got a link to the new website that's up and ready to go. We just need to change some verbiage and place settings and blog type stuff to fit what we want to say. That's basically all there is to it. It's ready to go. Once we get these, a few pictures and a few descriptions of a few parts of the website done, which can be done very quickly. Then we'll switch from the old website to the new website. And I expect that to happen in the next month.
Someone from Public last month said that he went on and it was outdated, but then at the end of the meeting, I thought I heard him walking out saying it's I hadn't checked it since a couple of days ago, but then
it was down.
He said it
wasn't running at all.
So we went
onto the website during the board meeting, and it was there, so I don't know if he was doing
maintenance. It looks pretty good. I'll send the link out so you can kind of look at it, of what it's there right now, and then when we change a few things, and our logo is going to be on our front page, and it'll be a watermark on the rest of the page, what's on the back of our business cards, you know, kind of through the pages, and then some stuff about us and what we do and stuff like that.
So all the enhanced services that are under the new contract they have with GovWise, that y'all is reflecting on the website.
Absolutely. Yeah, and he's already got all of our old content there, all of our meeting agenda, meeting notices, all that stuff is already there. He's updating that as a
still has his as a vice president, so it's not right today.
What's that?
That was printed yesterday. Still has Burlap as a vice president.
Well, the other thing I would like to see on the new website is PDFs of our monthly commissioner packets. There's just no reason a member of the public should not be able to just log in and see that.
Once the website goes live, he's going to train the trainer to do all the uploading, so it'll obviously be one of us, as well as maybe Angelique or something for now until we get these business person
Can
done.
You start also emailing us a PDF of these packets of the meeting so that we can put those on the website, because I've asked you to scan them in a couple of times, and for some reason those scans aren't working, they're very large, when they're scanning. The PDF would seem to be much easier, and then we can just put them on the website for, with the meeting, yeah, with the meeting minutes. No, just this, this document. We, you know, the scan is just such a huge file, that it's, you know, 37 megabytes or something, it's such a huge file. So if we got it in PDF, that was, as you created it, and it would be a problem, we could put it with, you know, June 2015 meetings, you know, just go down the line, so that if somebody wants to see what happened in December, they can look at the packet, they can look at the meeting minutes, and go from that, too. So, do you think that's a reasonable request, Mr. McCase?
Sure, I wish that we could get the GPS, like, to talk about this, but we just don't, so that we all know in day what's on the laundry list, because I think this is like the third or fourth thing that's been requested, and I'm hoping somebody will follow us. A note in me that is limited to three or four things that are actually being requested, not being supplemented as an ongoing wish list.
Fair enough.
I may have a lack of that. Yeah, I don't want to go.
Yeah, I don't think we need our account numbers going on public record.
I wasn't, actually, I wasn't talking about Bill's report. I was only talking.
That's a package. I mean, if we want to put out what the commissioners get, then they get, we get this.
Fair enough. I was, when I introduced it, I was talking about that, but you're right, that's what I wanted as well. Account numbers up there, very good point.
Account numbers that anybody should take and start to connect to our bank accounts, they have our account number.
Sure.
Then I'm probably gonna limit it, I'll put the last four numbers of each account number on there, so, because I've gotta fill that line in on that.
Do you understand what I mean?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. So, okay, leaving that report apart, I'm talking specifically about the.
We're gonna be transparent, this is what we spend.
This is what we see, this is our investments are. But we don't want our bank account numbers down to the.
I mean, when we get PIO's question.
I was just concerned that the scan, he's blacking it out, and the scan basically defeats the whole purpose of, now we've got the huge file. It would just go to, just like the report is one, pack it as a PDF. That way it's not such a huge, big, massive file.
How do I start sending, like I do nine and 10 and stuff, I'll just send you a name that we can pass it to.
Okay, I'll send it off to the.
And then you can send it on to the web guy, and I'll go in and see if I whack these numbers out on this, but it sends it to you, see how you.
On the request for, these items, of course, current minutes, but I can understand this, it can, I can't have, come through the minutes to see what it doesn't have basically in there. So when do you move the strike for Brad to be able to send you that? I'm not sure when they.
Before the start of the meeting.
Okay, anything else under website content?
Kevin's gonna send us all the links, right? Well, I want to see it before it goes live.
Pre-production link, yeah.
Don't you think we need to see it before it puts the truth?
Yeah.
The district has three request that it sent out, two on behalf, and one, John's involved, so he may be participating in this discussion. So we have, we received a request for information from the public, forwarded to Cypress Creek, which they responded to, that was... Also involved, I think, that was sent off, also sent off to the Texas Attorney General for something to be tactical and information. There is a second that was sent by, I think, we revealed last, that special meeting, Kevin had drafted a request, which we sent, and it was discussed by the partly under the PIA, there was also pursuant to the service agreement. A number of the items were not necessarily documented, but again, the question was under the service agreement, for the question of information. We got a response from Ms. Jesser on that. And a lot of it was withheld based on allusion to the privacy issue, but also to litigation. And then the third is a motion that was passed at the June meeting, which was communicated to Cypress Creek EMS, and Mr. King responded to that, took exception to some, but did, and again, that was made under the service agreement, but did also offer to provide access to some information on a limited basis. Meeting was going to be scheduled, which ended up not being able to be taking place yesterday.
We were hoping to get that report back for today.
Yeah, I think it had to do with the calendars, and I think this committee, for one, and there was discussion about the attorneys being there apparently at the special meeting. This committee was not made aware of this meeting, even though Cypress Creek was helping set up this time and date. And Karen took the lead on trying to get it set up, and it looked like we had a time and date set up, but
so we all still want to do that.
I'm waiting for somebody to tell me.
And our response was, and I think John sent it to you, don't worry about us saying yes or no. You tell us when and where, and I'll have somebody from our office, and I think Mr. King will also at this meeting. You don't need to look around our schedule.
Well, I sent the email out, and you all know when the response came in, so I can't say anymore because it becomes negative when I speak. So if someone wants to set up the meeting, I will be there. End of conversation.
And we need an agenda for the meeting, and it's going to need to be understood that what we're talking about at the meeting is looking at individual employees by name and by salary. That is called the law in camera. That is a private inspection. It's for the purpose of verifying that the money that the district is spending is in fact being spent on these folks. Non-disclosure agreements will be required of anybody who looks at that information. No cell phones, no photographing, no copying, none of that will be permitted. We are going to contest that through due process, through the legal process, and until we get a legal opinion that goes the other way, we're going to maintain employee privacy. We do agree with the district, subject to confidentiality, is entitled to verify that we do in fact have people on the payroll who are in fact medics and who are in fact being paid money. You're allowed to do that, it has to be held in confidence. If we don't have that agreement, which you will recall my email to you did specifically refer to on camera inspection for the purpose of that verifying the funds that are appropriately spent, if we don't have that agreement, then we can't have a meeting, at least not.
Who's going to set up the agenda?
I don't even know, I mean, I'm not quite certain, what is, we need an agenda to just take a look at what these guys are asking for. I think we've been beating that around the bush.
I think the agenda is, we had sent a specific letter asking, and you responded in kind, saying, this is what can be looked at, and there's those circumstances. But I do want to get clarified here. If we have two ESD board members come to do this review, are you saying that they cannot discuss that with the remaining board member?
They cannot discuss individual names and salaries, they can talk about their overall impression, they can talk about whether or not they think the numbers are legit, but they are not going to disclose matters that we have maintained consistently, a privacy issue.
Are you saying that two of my members of the board cannot report on this meeting to the other members of the board under this disclosure agreement that we're talking about?
They will not be allowed to discuss that Joe Blow makes $35,000 a year as a dispatcher.
Well, I'm going to disagree with you there.
I got two problems. One is I got an attorney client problem. Because if I'm at that meeting and I see something, you're asking me to sign a document where I cannot discuss it with my client. Part one. Part two is, let's say one of the two members of the ESD board are at this review and find something in their own mind that they think is wrong or unclear. They are not being there. They are subject to penalties under a disclosure agreement if they then report it back to my assistant attorney here or to another member of the ESD board. Then that's a meaningless meeting. I appreciate you extending that offer, but you know that sounds like the Nixon tapes where they had John Stennis, the 90-year-old senator, was going to listen to those 30 hours of tapes, and that was Nixon's disclosure. That, is that what you're asking us to operate on?
No, I'm not asking you to operate under anything like a 90-year-old senator.
I thought it was
I am saying what I have said all along, that we are not going to disclose names of employees and their salaries because that is private information. We are going to hold that in confidence. If the district has a legitimate concern that money is going somewhere that it shouldn't be going, or that we don't have these employees, or that they are not being paid, or whatever your concern is, you can inspect that information in camera, in private, subject to a non-disclosure agreement. Okay? And you can discuss generalities, but you cannot discuss specifics. We'll reduce it to writing. It'll be clear what can and cannot be discussed. But you're not going to do an end run on a position that we have tried to maintain consistency on from day one. We have produced everything else except certain privileged law enforcement matters. Everything else that we've been asked for. So we have drawn a bright line on specific employees' salary information. We will continue to draw that line. We are willing, as an accommodation, to show that information to the board in camera. If you want to use that accommodation as an opportunity to defeat everything that we've done, then with respect, the offer will have to be withdrawn.
So you're withdrawing it? Because it sounds like counsel is saying, first of all, I have some real issues with, I mean, they're public employees. We're using public funds to pay them. I can go on the City of Houston website and look up every single fireman, paramedic, county attorney, everybody that works for the City of Houston, and most major municipalities have that information publicly available, and for some reason you feel like the public employees that we have shouldn't have their salaries publicly available. We're not asking for social security numbers, we're not asking for other identifying information, we're simply asking for their name and how much they make, which you can get on the Cypress Creek ESD website for the teachers, you can get that for the City of Houston Fire Department. Every other public agency out there is complying with this, and you feel like, for some reason, this public agency shouldn't have to comply with that. So I have some real issues there.
First, I need to address your fundamental premise, which is completely in error. Cypress Creek employees are not public employees. They are not protected by any Civil Service Act. They have none of the rights and obligations of public employees. And in fact, before Cypress Creek became an independent contractor to ESD, Cypress Creek was 100% private, and everyone who went to work for Cypress Creek went to work with the reasonable expectation that their salary information would be held in confidence. Now, certain people, you, Mr. Burlett, Mr. Dolcefino, have, for some inexplicable reason, become fixated on the notion that because this private entity is now a contractor to ESD 11, that the employees of Cypress Creek should waive and lose the privacy that they once enjoyed. If the courts rule that that is in fact the law, we will comply with the court's ruling. But until we get a court ruling, sir, we are not going to disclose what we consider to be private information. It's that simple. It's been that simple all along, and why we continue to have these discussions is beyond me.
But let me ask you something. Do you have any idea how long it may take before the court is ruling? We obviously would like to clear up some matters which is hanging over our problem, you know, for some time.
Let's be clear on the ruling. The Attorney General has said what you're saying is incorrect, and that's why you sued them to get a court to tell us differently, correct?
That is the process for contesting the Attorney General rule.
Attorney General of the State of Texas has said Cypress Creek EMS employees, because they are paid with ESD 11 funds, are considered public employees and you need to disclose this information. And you disagree with them, and you have sued the State of Texas to say we disagree with what you're telling us in your AG's ruling.
And now we're required to do under the Public Information Act.
You're not required. You could have just complied with his opinion.
But we don't agree with that opinion.
Fair enough.
And that is the next step. It's not some evil step that CCMS is taking.
Correct.
That's the next step in the legal process.
We're just making sure we're on the same page for its question.
Because the district courts in Texas have the authority to interpret the Public Information Act just as well as the AG's office.
Okay.
That's what we're doing.
Okay. Mr. Cass, didn't you hire just for a outside consulting firm?
I was authorized and we're doing
right.
For, as an agenda.
And it came back and everything was...
Yeah, we've been thoroughly audited.
Now let's answer Fred's question.
Let's put that. Okay, first of all...
So what kind of time frame are we looking at for Fred's question?
We have no idea. It's a court. But let's also put something else on the table. It has been insinuated by certain board members from almost the inception of their arrival on the board that there have been financial issues at Cypress Creek EMS. Cypress Creek EMS invited the board, at the board's expense, to conduct a thorough, no-holds-barred audit, which the board did.
Okay, again, we're grandstanding and we're lecturing. Answer Fred's question and get on to the next point. We've already been through this. We don't need to go through it again. I don't need to be lectured by you.
You don't want to.
So let's answer Fred's question. We don't have a time frame, correct?
You don't want to hear it.
We've heard it enough.
We've been audited.
We've heard it enough. We've got all the information.
Why do you do that, board?
There's no point in hearing over and over and over again what we've already
heard. We do every board meeting.
He asked a question. Let's answer the question and get on to the next topic.
I think he did answer the question, so, and the answer is we're waiting on the court.
So what you're saying is, at this point, is if two of our board members go in and look at these records, and as Howard said, find something that they, whether erroneously or correctly, disagree with, those two board members can't discuss it either with co-counsel he can't discuss it with co-counsel, and those two board members can't discuss it with the rest of that. And if we don't agree to that, you are withdrawing the offer for us to come in and look at those records. Is that what I understood?
Your spin is an error. The records we're talking about are names of employees and their salaries. If for some reason you have an issue with what we're paying someone.
I have an issue that Rick England makes more than the chief of the city of Houston.
How much do I make?
We don't know. I mean, on your 990, you're saying you're making X dollars. You're saying he's the only person making more than $100,000 a year, but then there's W-2s out there that show that more people are making more than $100,000 a year. So now we're talking about if we come up with a list of six employees that are making more than $100,000 a year, and we want to talk about it either by name or by number, you're saying we can't do that. That's a concern that we have.
And why do you care if someone works a lot of overtime and makes over $100,000 a year? Why is that an
issue? That means the organization is being mismanaged and you need more full-time employees. That's all we're looking for is our money's being paid to you to put ambulances on the street. And if we've got multiple people that should be making $40,000 or $50,000 a year and they're making $120,000 a year, then that probably means we need to hire more full or part-time employees.
We've offered to give you that kind of information that you can tell, you can make those determinations without giving you names and specific salaries. We've offered to give you the data that will give you that information, but you don't want it.
Yeah.
That'd be a start.
It'd be a start. We haven't gotten there yet. So far, you're telling me that you're withdrawing your offer for us to view it in camera unless we agree to these.
You're mixing apples and oranges. And if you don't even need to look at anyone's salary. If your complaint is that you think that no one at Cypress Creek EMS should make more than X dollars a year, then just say so.
We don't know what they're doing. We don't know who they are.
We don't know what they're doing. We don't know who they are. How can we make that determination?
Why do you need to know who they are?
What do they do? Who they are and what do they do and how do they benefit the taxpayers of ESD 11?
We can tell you and we will tell you. And we have told you we will tell you. You are in the process of gathering the data right now. We will get you part of a survey. We will have in people with, let's take medics. Medics with 1 to 5 years in service, 6 to 10, 11 to 15, and so on. We will get you the number of folks in each of those ranges, how much overtime they're working over and above their ordinary overtime, and the average salary that's being earned in that quintile, comparing like to like.
That was in his letter. That is correct.
Let me ask you a question. Would it be acceptable to you if this committee goes in and reviews your payroll records like you've offered to let them do, and they came back and reported to the board there's four people making over $100,000, but as long as they don't say Robert Burlett is making $100,000 and Bill Russell is making $100,000, but if they come back and report to us that we have zero people making over $100,000 by the payroll records, or we have 50 people making over $100,000 based on the payroll record, and we get a determination of what the average hourly wage is for the different classifications of people, which you have offered that.
Yes.
What the going rate is.
As long as we protect anonymity.
That's my question.
As long as we protect anonymity.
So my question to you, again, so to be clear, these people go and look at your payroll records, and they should be allowed, I would think, they should be allowed to take those records and go down and we have X number, 15 employees making this range. They were paid this range. We have 13 employees that were paid this range. That they can come back and report that to the board after they've eyeballed and seen exactly what these payrolls are.
Propose,
you understand what I'm trying to say?
What I propose.
And they can come back, not individual, and say, oh hell, Brad Ringland's making $1 million a year off Cypress Creek EMS. But if they come back and say, we have five supervisors, five paramedics, we have three this, as long as they don't say, Joe Blow, Jane Doe, John Henry, are making above this, they can come back and summarize the data that they've looked at and be able to share that with the rest of the board members.
I think my problem with that is that that is the tail wagging the dog. We're the ones that are writing the checks, and they're the ones that are dictating to us what we get to see.
And you're wanting to see what they're being paid. He's offered to let you see that. Let these people go in and take a look. Let the courts...
By his concessions. No, it's our money. It's the taxpayers' money, and they're telling us what they will or won't let us see. We are the stewards of this money.
He's offered to let you look at their entire payroll records, so I...
He hasn't offered it to me. He's offered it to the committee.
Well, he's offered it to the committee. Well...
Okay, and then he says that they can't even discuss it with me. So that's not offering to me.
Now, that is what I'm trying to clarify right now, Robin.
I understand.
That is what I'm trying to clarify.
You're clarifying in vague...
I'm clarifying that we can go in and look at those records and be able to discuss it as long as, according to his terms, as long as I don't say...
According to his terms is the problem that I have with that sentence. It shouldn't be according to his terms. We're not letting the tail wag the dog here.
Let's start on something.
We've been starting on something for a year.
We have an offer. We have a good explanation how we can go forward with something to clarify and hopefully come up to some determination which is very advisable to the board. We got to start somewhere. That's my opinion, just like...
I didn't.
Okay, Howard, let's discuss this. Are we going to have a legal issue taking the oath of office we took as elected officials going in here and then not being able to discuss what we saw with our tax money?
Well, it's not a question of your oath of office. I expressed what my reservations were. I can't, as an attorney, sign a non-disclosure.
And
if I see something that I need to disclose to my board, I am somehow prevented from doing that. I mean, I just don't know how I can agree to that.
Lawyers sign non-disclosure agreements all the time.
Doesn't mean they necessarily should, though.
And if the attorney feels that it's a detriment to the client,
just take it off the table, and we'll go back to when it comes out in court.
All he's talking about here are individual names and salaries. He's not talking about a non-disclosure agreement with respect to all the other information that we have offered to provide you in order to, so that you can determine and confirm that your money is being spent efficiently.
Okay.
Fair enough. We'll hire an outside auditor just for that purpose. And they say it was...
I make a motion that we remove the EMS payroll and communication center wages from the invoice of Cypress Creek EMS until the litigation is settled with the Texas Attorney General.
So you're going to jeopardize everybody's life.
And so that you guys can do that.
On 11.
I make a motion that we remove those from the invoice on item 11 on the agenda until we get through that solution, and hopefully it goes quickly. Do I have a second?
Let's get done with 17, 18, and 20. Let's get done with 17, 18, and 20, and we'll go back to it.
We haven't taken up item 11, so we need to take up item 11.
Okay, under item 11, I move that we remove those from their invoice, or we don't pay them on those items until the Attorney General comes out with their decision or they choose to comply with our request to release the information to us. Do I have a second?
I think we need to see where we are and then we'll discuss this. So we're still on 17, 18, and 20. Do we need to do something to leave 17, 18, and 20 to go to 11? Or do we need to finish 17, 18, and 20 and then go back to 11 and discuss?
We are on item 17, 18, and 20. Discussing all of those.
We're discussing them all together.
Not 11.
No, we were doing 17, 18, 11, and 20.
No, 11 was to be held after we took up item 18.
Howard, we need your opinion. We need both of y'all's opinions now that something is different than what we thought, and you're saying you're not going to sign an NDA that wasn't discussed before we discussed this. What are your feelings now?
Stand by what I said. I don't know how I can represent the ISD 11. I guess I'm willing to wait to see what the non-disclosure agreement would say, but even when businesses do business, sell each other and buy assets, non-disclosure says you can still talk to your accountant, you can still talk to your lawyer. I can't put myself in a position that I'm representing myself as an attorney to a fellow attorney and say that I'm going to abide by an agreement and then somehow be possibly compromised on another obligation I have to a client. Now, I think I tend to agree that, to me, as a legal matter, I don't know that it matters whether John Smith made this much and this much overtime. And I think Ms. Jessup had a good recommendation that to start with, to have what their payroll is so that you can actually determine how many of your people are in fact working overtime. You know, does it mean that we need more part-time, full-time employees? That's a very valid question, and that's the kind of data that may in fact give it to you. But with regard to an in-camera review of other information, I have to have the ability to represent a client. John Peeler from my office has the ability to represent a client. The client is ESD.
As well as we would have the obligation to come back and inform this board of the same information.
I think it just, I understand that the John Stennis joke maybe fell flat, but the fact of the matter is that, if one of you see something and you feel it's important enough to share, I think we have to address that in some way.
Otherwise, the deliberative process is completely cut out. You don't get to operate as a board.
Now, as far as John Smith earning this much money as a line item, like I said, it's not that big a deal for me because I think you're getting all the information that you want. But if that's the information that you want, and that's another issue. That's not the meeting that we were trying to arrange for. So we have to be clear on what we're asking. We did ask for the payroll records, and we did ask it by name. We did ask for that. They're coming back saying, in order not to compromise their legal position, this is the kind of review they want to have.
And I appreciate your position. I think they should take that position.
Well,
they can do that. But we also have the right to not pay for any more of those fees until it's taken care of.
I'd like to see that in the contract.
Y'all are in breach of the contract so many ways, and it's unconscionable on that. Our contract's unconscionable anyways. But regardless,
And what is the ramification for public safety if they stop funding Cypress Creek? When they can't meet payroll.
They clearly have plenty of money.
When they can't meet payroll and these people stop showing up for work or start looking for other jobs. What are the ramifications to public safety if we defund Cypress Creek and the people that are doing a damn good job on these ambulances, winning awards?
We're still paying the health insurance, and we're still paying all of the other items on here. We're just taking those two line items out until it comes clear whether they are or are not going to give us the information about exactly what we're paying.
So we're
going
to hold paramedics and the EMTs and the drivers hostage.
The decisions that they make on the other side of the table are not our problem. We're done with the tail wagging the dog.
When we can't provide an ambulance to somebody that needs one, that's ESD 11's problem.
When
people die, that's ESD 11's problem.
You're projecting events into the future that may or may not happen. I'm talking about what we can do
If we stop paying for paramedics and EMTs, which is what we pay for, which is the line item we pay for,
We think that's what we're paying for. We don't know what we're paying for. That's the issue.
Because we don't know. We have hundreds of thousands of dollars. We have no idea what we're paying for.
We have had an audit that traced our tax dollars directly to the payroll. And it was clear our tax dollars were going into the buckets that they were designed to go into.
Okay.
So what is the argument?
The argument is we requested under the terms of our contract these documents. They responded back, we don't have to give it to you because of a litigation we started, we don't have to give it. And the fact is that the contract and the public information request are two totally different things. They are contractually obligated to give us documents that we reasonably request, which we have. This is a reasonable request.
But we've had an audit that basically says it's all copacetic. So what are you really looking for, Robert? I want to know what you're really looking for.
The documents that were requested in the letter from Mr. Katz.
And because it's subject to the lawsuit, it's not going to happen until that's done.
It shouldn't be understated that the documents that they're claiming are subject to the litigation is a litigation that they started. The Attorney General came out and said, no, these are public documents, give them to them. And they said, oh, no, wait, we're going to tie it up in court for another God knows how long. They may appeal it. It could go for 10 years.
Okay.
the fact is that the attorney, you know, this isn't exactly cutting-edge legal theory here.
And the paramedics and the com center and all those people are still out there doing their jobs every day, day in and day out, without complaint, might I add, except by you two. I don't see the public in here hop, screaming and yelling that nothing's happening.
That's why they elected us, Ms. Plummer.
They elected us for what? We've had an audit. The auditor came back. He said it was perfect. I mean, I'm sorry. What else do you want him to say?
There is no end to the paranoia. We will.
Again, I don't call transparency paranoia.
We will make every reasonable effort. We will make every reasonable effort to once again demonstrate that every penny that ESD 11 pays to Cypress Creek EMS goes for the stated purpose, consistent with maintaining the anonymity of our employees and their specific payroll data. Now, if that is too difficult of a concept for you gentlemen to understand, then I don't know, write it out in Crayola on a big chief tablet, whatever it takes to get the idea across. But I'm telling you this, you do not have the contractual right to demand any kind of data you want from Cypress Creek EMS, declare that to be a material breach of the contract, and withhold payment under the contract. Okay? You don't have people manning the ambulances. You don't have the services that you're paying for and the citizens expect without money coming in from ESD 11. It's that simple. That's been the contract from day one, and we have fulfilled our end of the contract from day one. Ambulances on the street, fully staffed with the finest paramedics and the finest equipment in the country. That's what the ESD citizens have paid for. That's what they have gotten.
Question is, do we start out, do we take the report to show what salaries are, what overtime is, without individual names being shown? We'll follow up and do our internal review and go from there.
You've got to advise us on that, whether signing an NDA is going to prohibit us from doing our job as elected officials of this tax money.
Well, I would need to see it. I would certainly want to put something in there that protects both the individual board members as well as district council on what may be revealed in that review. I can't walk into a review and give away the right to be able to advise my client. So if it addresses the concerns of like an executive session, essentially, that if the attorney has a...
If you need to discuss individual names, individual salaries, executive session, that's fine. The information needs to be kept out of the public domain until the court's rules.
That satisfies me.
And it's just that information. It's just the names and salaries.
Yeah, the rest of it is fair game for public discussion. We've got an issue.
That allows me to do what I would need to do, and that allows the board to be advised what the board needs to do.
I think that's the way to go.
Now, once we get all this done, can we bring this ridiculous sideshow to an end? You know,
we ask for documents. You don't even come to me.
Excuse me, hang on a second. Yeah, you're in from out of town wanting to be reimbursed because you're going to law school up in Texas Tech. This is your first meeting in 6 months, so please.
But unfortunately, you're incorrect.
Second meeting in 11 months.
My error.
Executive session. My error. I think it's fine.
But that would require Robert be here if he wants to discuss it for executive session. So. Just put it on the table.
But what, Robert's the one that wants to tell everybody's salary, so I think that there should be a different deal. I think the deal should be Ms. Plummer, Mr. LaBeouf, and you, and we don't care, because I know you're professional enough that you're not going to tell anybody's salary. I know he's professional enough. I know she is. I know the other two
are going to tell everybody. Now we have a contractor dictating to us who's going to be on our committees and who's not.
That way we don't have an issue. They can
how much longer are we going to let the contractor dictate to us what he will and will not do?
If he...
should be all regular.
I think that's going to give us some information.
It's a good start, in case you do it.
The board is conceding to way too much there. I think it should be, the ESD board says.
So I have not conceded anything.
I think that the ESD board should say, give it to us, period, end of story, and if you don't give it to us, then you're in breach of contract and we're not paying. That's the way an ESD should answer this question. And you guys are talking about, well, now what if we do it this, or how do you do it?
And again, what is the ramification to public safety within this huge service area if we can't provide paramedics?
They have the key. They have the key to release them from that.
So again, you want to hold paramedics and the EMTs and the drivers hostage?
They're the ones holding the keys. They can release themselves from that anytime they want.
And the next paranoid fantasy you have that requires more information, you'll hold the same sword over our head. No, sir, we're drawing a line right here. If you want to defund Cypress Creek EMS over this ridiculous sideshow, when we have offered to do everything except disclose employee names and salaries, then by golly, throw down the gun.
Okay, so let's say the ridiculous sideshow is the state of Texas interpreting a law saying you need to do something and you disagree with them. And now a criminal case has been opened for the same thing, saying you need to do something and you're not going to do it. And we're the sideshow? I don't think so, sir.
I'm the
Harris County DA? I don't think so.
Your boy,
Harris County DA.
Your boy, Wayne Dolcefino.
My boy, okay. You need to get your terms correct again. That Wayne Dolcefino is not my boy.
He already published last night that you two were going to bring this up today.
And you already knew about this.
Last night.
He put it on his email.
Yeah, you ought to be sure.
Website last night that you two were going to bring it up.
Yes, we did.
Let's put on.
Time out.
I did it.
We're taking it off the table. Until the district attorney comes up, you will receive.
Are not going to have on the table.
That's not the way this should be. We offer to be nice and let you do it.
What, where are we on the agenda now? I'm not sitting here listening to all this bannery back.
We are, as far as I can tell, we are on items 17, 18, and 20. Robert was looking to move into item 11. We're continuing on those items, and what was and now apparently is not being discussed is the committee meeting with the ability to discuss what's at reveal and executive session.
And it's my understanding he has offered to do it at a board meeting in executive session.
What I'm saying is that we can talk about it.
The proposal, if we have an agreement that brings this conversation to an end, this is not an agreement so that we can move the goalposts again 6 weeks or 8 weeks down the line, is you will see names and salaries. You will have survey data that will let you relate those names and salaries to the survey data. The survey data will be public.
But that data will be available to the board members that are present. I don't have to get a duly called meeting, because right now I've got two people designated to review that data. We did that last month. We did that at the special meetings. We designated two people. We can't have three there, because then it's a quorum and I have to do a notice. So the difference is we could do that at a board meeting, at a duly called board meeting, go into executive session, and all board members be able to look at the data and not have to rely on somebody to report it to us. We all see the same thing. We all hear the same thing. We all visualize the same entity, the same numbers. I'm not finished. Is that what I'm understanding, that we're moving from the committee to everyone on the board has the opportunity to come in and review the payroll data?
That is actually not.
In executive session.
That's not what we were discussing.
I think that's not.
What I'm saying is that the committee can do what we're talking about. Both myself and those members of this committee will have the ability to talk with the whole board in executive session.
I'm not changing the committee. Committee is
is Devin here to share.
At the executive session of this board, district board, we'd be able to talk about information that we think is necessary.
We can talk about general, in meetings, out of meetings, we can talk about specific in an executive session.
That's, yes.
Okay, then I'm okay with that too.
And Howard, you don't see any issues?
We have to have an understanding, it has to be a motion from this board passed. And once we do all that, we're done. We're through on the topic of who's making how much money and what kind of data has to be disclosed. Now, I don't mind doing a rinse and repeat next year on the same terms and conditions. We're not going to beat this to death every dadgum meeting, because it takes up a lot of time and a lot of money on our side.
Well, I don't even know what that means.
Yeah, I don't.
You lost me there.
You guys picked the fight with the attorney general and you're talking about spending money.
Let me try to clarify.
Pick three fights with the attorney general.
Actually, no. These fights are being picked by Wayne Dolcefino, who's being paid by someone. We haven't figured that out yet, but that's another issue. Once we do all of this, once you get the salary data and you get the ranges and the reports and you know what you need to know about who's making what money, will that be the end of it, or is this going to be death by a thousand cuts? Because if it's death by a thousand cuts, at some point we're going to have to say no.
Mr. Beeler,
I'd like to meet with our council to discuss this issue, not in a public session. Can we do that in our report?
Well, you're asking me to advise you. I need to be able to advise you in an executive session.
I'm asking for advice from our council.
But what I'm, the only thing I'm, you know, I mean, the non-disclosure agreement, I thought we had addressed, but it sounds like Andrew.
I want a commitment that once you look at the data, that this year, you're not going to ask for the same data again to be made public.
I mean, you're asking us not to do what the taxpayer voted us to here to do.
No. You're wrapping yourselves in the taxpayer flag. It's the last refuge of scoundrels. The taxpayers don't care that someone, yes, I'm paraphrasing. The taxpayers don't care that we have.
You guys wrap yourselves in the saving lives flag, too.
And yes, and actually.
That's what we do very well.
We walk the walk.
I'm here to represent the taxpayers, so.
Yeah, sure you are.
You got to wrap yourself.
Down from Lubbock.
Item number 20 is you can take action on engaging the special counsel to assist with the district. Do you have a recommendation for that? No.
That would be part of our discussion. Apparently, we're going to go into executive session to discuss the legal implications of what's been proposed.
Okay. So, do you want to go into executive session now, or do we want to move
on? No, I will.
Item 11.
No.
Well, I think item 11 is going to probably be a derivative of whatever.
Okay. So after a 3-minute break, which we've been at this time for 2.5 hours, 2 hours and 15 minutes.
Do you want to get public comment out of the way real quick?
Are there any public comments?
I would, but I'm afraid I'd get in trouble.
You stay in trouble.
Thank
Fred.
You, Fred.
Okay. All right. 3-minute break. We'll come back when you've got the session.
Which is the
20, you're going to get a CD.
The ties on the three lawyers. And 20, and
are you going to what?
He's going to get a CD on the three attorneys each.
And are you in conflict in this one? Can you conflict check?
Oh, they'll do that.
Well.
Item 18.
Discussing the, why don't you state the way you want this to go down?
Justice not here. So Ms. Jessett had suggested that the full Cypress Creek salary listing without names would be made available. The in-camera inspection would be made available subject to an agreed non-disclosure agreement.
the hourly rates for...
No, that was not the records.
That's not on that, but...
Those are the two, wasn't that?
That was the two, but we've also asked for...
First one was everybody.
No, that was an adjusted head office without names, and then the in-camera with names for the two members of the committee to be able to look at. I would first review to determine the non-disclosure.
And it would be helpful if we could get average hourly rate.
We're trying to pay scale, talk about budgeting, so we need to know how much ET basics make, how much ET intermediates make, dispatchers make, whether you want to do that as an hourly or whether it's a stated amount, what. So we have some number to go off of to calculate.
Maybe an overtime.
Right, and let me...
The approval thing, I think.
Yeah, I think I'm going to work on it. It's time consuming because there's a number of employees and we're drilling down fairly deep in the data. But what we want y'all to have at the end of the day is to be able to look at, okay, people with 20 years of service make considerably more than people with 5 years of service. So you really can't say there's an average because you're comparing apples to oranges when you try to average in that fashion. So we're trying to give you a representative slice, you know, for each.
Not representative.
No, you're going to, sorry, when I say representative, it will account, it'll have a number of employees in a particular cohort. Bottom salary, top salary, average salary, and overtime, but you have to understand there's two kinds of overtime. We have overtime that is built into the basic pay system. We have overtime that's over and above that. And, you know, to your comment about if someone is racking up a huge amount of overtime, let me tell you what the situation is there, because it's a policy decision that you guys may want to weigh in, right? We have...
If you've got 30 people, and I'm throwing some numbers out, but if you have 30 people that are making huge overtime amounts...
We don't.
Let me finish. The conclusion that I would make when I was CEO of a hospital was that we need staff. We need staff to reduce that overtime cost. Cost it one time is certainly a lot cheaper than cost it time.
Kind of short. Because there's several issues that compete here. Just want them on the table for y'all's information. We don't have currently paramedics sitting around waiting on a salary, on duty, waiting to fill a vacancy that hasn't occurred. Follow what I'm saying?
Yeah.
If somebody calls in sick in the morning and says, I won't be there this shift, we don't have a standby paramedic to fill that spot. That spot gets filled by someone who is going to be, by definition, working overtime. Likewise, we don't have...
Why not? Why not?
Why don't we have spare paramedics?
Or do you have an on-call list of people who are available that day who can come in?
Well, yeah, but they get paid overtime when they come in.
Okay.
Again, the numbers that we're going to provide will help us.
We don't want to get into the minutiae of the management.
But I'm trying to explain it because it's voluntary who comes in and works overtime.
Right. We understand.
We have a small number of people who, for whatever reason, work a ton of overtime. Yeah, that's just happens.
Yeah.
Now, the numbers, the gross numbers at the end of the day won't be any different. If somebody else worked that overtime, the aggregate number is going to be the same. You follow what I'm saying?
I do.
I don't want anybody reading too much into the notion that we have a couple of people who are hitting it out of the park on numbers.
The data's going to be the data, so
We just need the date.
Yeah. All right. And we're going
to... Subject to Howard being happy with whatever you want to work out, we're okay.
The other thing was we asked about the general ledger last, apparently, was it last month or?
What you gave us last month?
Last month, that was supposed to be part of our packet. Can we get a general?
It was what Brad did, brought us in last.
Oh, that extra piece in hand.
Stuff like that.
Can we get that email to us by close of business today? I'll email Howard.
Somebody email out a copy of that due to it. It was for the last year.
Thank you.
Well, before I, you will have it yesterday, Thursday.
Yeah.
We'll have it by the close of business tomorrow.
No.
Yeah, it's all done, printed off, and I gave it to Kim.
I'm gonna send an email right now when we get that.
Is there any other business for the board?
Is there any other business for the board?
Long time ago, we asked for, and you refused to do it, and I'm gonna ask again, we need data in here. We've gotta be able to access these hundreds of millions of papers and documents that we've been getting over the last few years, so we go back and make reference to. You have a guest Wi-Fi, you said you wouldn't turn it on before, can we get it turned on for our meeting so we can use data in here?
I'll do it, Tom.
Wi-Fi.
The wireless.
Wi-Fi, so we can hook up for iPads or computers.
We don't have a hook up in this room, I don't think.
Yeah, it's, I see the signal 100% perfect, but cellular data in here is horrible, so I can't use an iPad to go back and look at it.
You could meet in a different room. You can meet down there, and they do it all the time down there.
No, your signal is here, it just needs to be turned on. You need a password, you said you wouldn't, I mean, last time I asked you, you said we couldn't have it.
Public access, public password?
It's a guest, it says Ccemsa guest Wi-Fi, and I still need a password.
So that's, so we can have data over sitting here.
I think it's not, does that one not work?
Maybe that's it.
Try that, see.
That's right.
That it?
Just an eraser?
I think it, no, I think it's guest.
It's an eraser holder.
It might be GU3ST 2002.
Yeah, it is.
Oh.
That it?
There it is, right there.
It works.
Yeah.
GU3ST 2002.
Another conspiracy.
You are smart.
We have major milestone.
There we go. It's only been 3.5 years.
Nice meeting, sir. Yes, sir.
Glad someone's paid attention to the board.
I didn't know that John needed that, sorry. I knew it because I got it for great.
Incorrect password, didn't work.
Yeah, it did.
Is that password not working?
It's me, husband.
Not for guests, anyway.
Yeah, that's good.
Did, you got it? You did GU3ST 2002.
You changed this to.
It's GU3.
And I gotta get the.
Me too, I've got like 7 hours worth of work to do.